There are some important differences between AMD's new 8-core Ryzen 7 5800H and Intel's 8-core i7-10875H laptop processors that you need to know about. I'll show you all the differences in this comparison. These are the differences in specs between these two processors. Both are 8-core 16-thread parts with 16 meg of cache. The Ryzen chip has a higher base clock, but much lower boost clock. Both are listed with a 45W TDP, but I'll explain shortly why that doesn't matter much. Otherwise, there are some differences to memory speed. For this comparison, I'm using the XMG Neo 15, the same Tongfeng chassis as the Electronics Mech 15 G3. I've got the 2020 model with the i7 and the new 2021 version with the 5800H. And both laptops were tested with 32GB of memory and dual channel. However, Ryzen runs the memory kit at DDR4 3200 CL22, while Intel runs the same memory at DDR4 2933 CL21. Now, there are some Intel 10875H laptops that do have XMP support for DDR4 3200, but many do not, including this one. So I think it's still a fair comparison as this is an actual platform difference. And many of the tests aren't memory bound anyway. Now, despite both laptops being the same model, there are some generational differences. The older Intel model uses liquid metal while the newer Ryzen one does not. And the new Ryzen model is a little thicker than last gen. The heatpipe layout is also a bit different inside. So I guess not perfectly directly apples to apples comparable, but this is the best I can do. Both of these machines should offer pretty much best case performance from these CPUs, as they allow the processor to run with higher power limits. But I have also tested with both capped to a 45W TDP. Unfortunately, I don't think this is going to be all that useful though. Intel and AMD calculate TDP differently. Here's the TDP reported by Hardware Info with the Blender Open Data benchmark running, which is a heavy multi-core workload. I've got the power limited results down the bottom and the no limit results above. As expected, software shows both running at 45W with my cap in place. However, with no limit, the Intel chip is significantly higher. Here's what actual power draw from the wall looks like. This is for the entire laptop, but both do have the same screens and other components. So the majority of this difference is down to the active CPU workload. With both capped to a 45W TDP, the 5800H is using 15% more wattage. However, the i7's power draw increases much higher when it's not restricted, requiring 29% more power now than the 5800H in this Blender test. Now, that wouldn't be an issue if the performance was actually there to back it up, but it's not. These are the results from the Blender benchmark that I used to measure the power draw. With both set to a 45W TDP, the Ryzen 7 5800H is completing the task 34% faster despite using 15% more power. With both processors no longer power limited, the 5800H's lead lowers to it being 20% faster. But remember that with no power limit in place, the i7 is drawing 29% more power from the wall, just to perform worse. As we saw earlier, the cooling is a bit different between these two laptops. And the Intel laptop does have liquid metal. This would definitely be helping here. As XMG told me, this offers a 9 degree Celsius improvement. So this is probably why the i7 is running cooler in this test despite using more power with no limits. The reason XMG aren't offering liquid metal here is it's apparently more risky to apply due to the layout. These are the clock speeds over all 8 cores during the same test. The i7 is able to clock slightly higher with no TDP limit. But don't forget, it's using more power and actually completing the task slower, as there are of course plenty of other differences between them that affect performance than just this. So basically, I don't really think the 45W TDP thing is a fair comparison between Intel and AMD, but I do think it will be useful for comparing against laptops that do actually have a 45W power limit. Without power limits, the Ryzen 7 5800H is simply more power efficient compared to the i7-10875H in this particular multi-core test. Realistically, to do a proper comparison, I'd have to modify power limits while measuring the power of both from the wall, and then pick some random TDP such that both laptops are drawing the same amount of power from the wall. And while that may be cool for science, I don't think it's really that practical, as I don't think anyone's going to be running these at that specific TDP value. So it just wouldn't represent how anyone's actually going to use these. Alright, now with all that groundwork laid, let's have a look at some other tests, followed by gaming on the iGPU afterwards. Let's start with Cinebench R23, as this includes both single and multi-core tests. The 5800H was scoring 15% higher in single core with both power limits capped, however the multi-core score was 44% higher. With no power limits in place, the Intel system closes the gap a little in the multi-core test, but it's still no match for Ryzen. I've also tested the older Cinebench R20, as a lot of people still use it, so you can use these numbers for comparing my results with. The margins were similar, and like R23, for some reason single-core scores were slightly better on Ryzen with the power limit in place. Though it's margin of error stuff. That wasn't the case in Geekbench, where single-core scores were basically the same on Ryzen, whether or not it was power limited. Like the other tests, it's a win for Ryzen in both multi and single-thread threaded tests. V-Ray uses the processor to render out a scene. This is a multi-core test, and another win for the 5800H. Now with both at a 45W TDP, Ryzen was scoring 38% higher, though as we saw earlier, the 45W thing isn't a fair comparison anyway. With both processors doing the best they can, Ryzen was now just 6% higher. The Corona benchmark is another multi-threaded rendering workload, and again similar results, with the 5800H completing the task around 6% faster without any arbitrary power limits in place. Though it was 26% faster with the 45W TDP, Handbrake was used to convert a 4K H.264 video file that I shot to 1080p H.265. Again, the 5800H was completing the task faster regardless of whether or not we're power limited. The 5800H was 13% faster with no limits, or 24% faster with the 45W limits. Adobe Photoshop was tested with the Puget System's benchmark. The scores didn't change too much with the higher power limits compared to most of the other workloads. And worst case, the 5800H was still scoring 25% higher than the i7 in this test. Microsoft Excel followed a similar pattern to the other tests. The 5800H was completing the task faster, though the gap does narrow in when both aren't power limited. Power limits didn't seem to affect the Intel processor when it came to AES encryption and decryption speed. Again, the 5800H had the lead in both cases. These are the differences when looking at all of the applications just tested with the 45W TDP in place. Regardless of the workload in use, the Ryzen 7 5800H was the winner, by as little as 10% to as much as 40 to 50% depending on the specific test. Comparing with the 45W TDP limit isn't particularly fair as Intel and AMD measure this differently though, but it is a limit that many laptops do actually have in place. Here's how things look if we instead don't have any power limits in place. In some of these workloads, thermals may actually become the next barrier, so in theory, the i7 machine could have an edge there due to its liquid metal application. At the end of the day though, it doesn't change the conclusion, because the Ryzen 7 5800H was still doing better in all workloads tested. Results here could vary a bit depending on the specific laptop though, but I believe this showcases near best case results for both processors. Both the Intel and AMD processors have integrated graphics, so let's see how well they do in games. I've tested Shadow of the Tomb Raider at 720p with the highest setting preset using the game's built-in benchmark, as this test reported that both laptops were 100% GPU bound. The Nvidia graphics were disabled during this test. The 5800H was reaching an average frame rate 278% higher than the 10875H. 10th gen Intel integrated graphics just isn't great for gaming, but with AMD's Vega, you've at least got a shot at 720p with lower settings. Now to be fair, it's probably pretty unlikely that you'll be using one of these CPUs without discrete graphics. But I think it's still important to compare all aspects. Both of these two laptops unfortunately have different discrete Nvidia graphics, which is why proper gaming benchmarks were not possible here. Hopefully I'll be able to cover this in a future video, it just depends what machines I get sent. I just need two with the same GPU, and I'm really interested to test it because there are some PCIe lane differences between Intel and AMD. Intel connects to the GPU with 16 lanes, while AMD uses 8, and I really want to know what sort of difference, if any, that makes. So yeah, stay tuned for that. Now, Intel did recently replace the 10875H with the 10870H, presumably due to availability issues. I'm guessing the 10870H is just a 10875H that didn't quite make the bin, kind of like what we saw with the 10850K and 10900K. The 10870H is basically just the same thing, just with a 100MHz lower base and boost clock speeds. So if anything, I would expect the 5800H's lead to be a little better there. Speaking of supply issues, XMG have publicly stated that there are shortages on Zen 3 laptop processors, so it might be hard to get a new Ryzen laptop with the 5800H, and depending on how long you want to wait, an Intel option might be the only choice. Now, Intel's 8-core did launch in Q2 last year, while the 5800H only just came out in 2021, so it's going to be really interesting to revisit this comparison once Intel 11th gen 8-core laptops are here. You're definitely going to want to make sure you're subscribed for that upcoming content. For now though, I'll show you how the 5800H compares against the older 4800H from last generation in this video over here, so I'll see you over in that one next.